Greetings and welcome to the Asian American and Asian Research Institute's Final Lecture Series online edition. My name is Anthony Wong, Program Coordinator for the Institute. I'd like to welcome all of you home or at your home office tonight for our talk by distinguished Professor Pyong Min to discuss his newly published book, Korean Comfort Women, Military Brothels, Brutality, and the Redress Movement, a comprehensive examination of both the comfort woman issue and the contemporary redress movement for the victims of Japanese military sexual slavery. Tonight's talk by Professor Min will be, he will be providing a brief overview of his 12 chapter book and discuss in length chapter 3, Emergence of the Comfort Woman Issue and Korean Comfort Women's Breaking Silence. Professor Min has spoken numerous times at the Institute, most recently on his anthology, Koreans in North America, their 21st century experiences. And so we're honored to have him here with us tonight to speak. If you're interested in watching his past video talks, those videos are available online on our website and YouTube channel. Tonight's topic is indeed very timely, as just 2 days ago, a judge in South Korea ruled that Korean women who were forced into sexual slavery by Japan during World War II could not seek compensation from the Japanese government in the South Korean court, contradicting an earlier ruling in January, where the presiding judge ordered that the Japanese government pay 100 million won, which is equivalent to $89,400 US, each to 12 former Korean comfort women. So I'm sure Professor Min will share some of his thoughts on that recent ruling and also discuss the controversial article recently by a Harvard Law professor on comfort women during our Q&A session. Pyong Min is Distinguished Professor of Sociology at Queens College and CUNY Graduate Center. He also serves as the Director of the Research Center for Korean Community at Queens College. Dr. Min's areas of interest include immigration, ethnic identity, ethnic business, immigrants, religious practices, and family gender, with a special focus on Asian and Korean Americans. He is the author of 6 books, 5 of them focusing on Korean immigrants' experiences. They include Caught in the Middle, Korean Communities in New York and Los Angeles, which is the winner of 2 National Book Awards, and also Preserving Ethnicity Through Religion in America, Korean Protestants and Indian Hindus Across Generations, which is the winner of 3 National Book Awards, 1 in Korea and the other 2 in the United States. Dr. Min is the editor and co-editor of books, including Encyclopedia of Racism in the United States, 3 volumes, and Asian Americans Contemporary Trends and Issues, the 2nd edition. He was a Russell Sage Foundation Fellow in 2006 and 2007, where he wrote his 2008 book, Ethnic Solidarity for Economic Survival, Korean Green Grocers in New York City. He has also received the Distinguished Career Award from the International Migration Section of the American Sociological Association in 2012, and also at the contribution to the Field Award from the Section of the Asia and Asia America of the American Sociological Association in 2019. And without further ado, please welcome tonight's speaker, Professor Pyong Min.
Thank you, Anthony, giving nice introduction to my background and organizing this Zoom meeting, working very hard. And I want to express thanks to Joyce Moy, Executive Director of ARI, for inviting me. Today, I will talk about beginning of a redress movement in South Korea. Very recently, my compliment book was published. I just quickly review, introduce my book. I started this book project in 1995, and I visited Korea 5 times for data collection between 95 and 2001. Then my main area of study is immigration and Asian American, and I spent too much time for complement project. I was behind, so I stopped at that point. And then I restarted book project, complement book project, after Japanese and Korean government reached agreement, not acceptable agreement, political deal to resolve the issue at the end of 2015. And then from 2016 and until 2020, full 5 years I spent. I worked very hard. The book has 14 chapters, devoting 30 chapters to intro, theory, concept, and conclusion. I have devoted 6 chapters to the complement issue that include their long journey from compost station to home. Some people spent 30 years here. And then I devoted 5 chapters to Redress Movement, 2 chapters on Korea, movement in Korea, and then 1 chapter in Japan, and then another chapter in the United States. But today, I'm not going to talk about book. I just introduce chapter 3, focusing on emergence of the compartment issue and Korean compartments breaking silence around 1990. So I will talk about beginning of a movement led by single-handedly led by women's movement leaders and women's organization. Before I start, why the issue was buried? You know, they came back in 1995, some people 1948. Some people spent 2 or 3 years coming back, yeah. But still, 1948, long ago, they came back, but they kept silent, and the issue was buried. Here, quickly, several factors. I covered this in chapter 2. US and British government's representative, they rejected the compartment issue as a major crime in Tokyo War Crimes Tribunal trial. They collected data, but they ignored them. And they don't want to give too much trouble to Japan because Soviet Union and China were emerging as communist countries. And, you know, they want to use Japan to contain communism, North Korea, communist government. So don't give a hard time to Japan, just they made it easy, and a company issue was not included. And then Korea was divided into 2 halves, North and South. In 1948, 2 governments were established, and then quickly they had a Korean War. So no time to think about company issue. Some people, many Korean forced workers and soldiers witnessed what happened at compost station, but they couldn't, you know, think about this issue. And then at the end of South Korean War, South Korea went through 26 years of military dictatorship from 61-87, they completely controlled military dictators and very much pro-Japanese. And they tried to normalize the relationship with Japan without solving these historical problems. These are external factors, but internally, compartment victims, survivors, they could not come out because of rigid patriarchal tradition, stigmatizing victims of sexual violence. They were treated as prostitute. So I am talking about beginning of women's movement and complement Redress Movement. South Korea was very patriarchal, but Western Christian missionaries arrived in North and South Korea around 1885. And they established churches and many schools, including many girls' school. And so women were able to attend the church and girls' school. That moderated Korean patriarchal tradition. In particular, Korean Church Women United established 1961, and Korean Women's Association United 1987. These two organizations played a key role in changing stigmatizing victims of sexual violence by attacking perpetrators of sexual violence. most of Redress activist women, they were Christians. Here I can give several names. Yoon Jong-ok, Yoon Mi-hang, Yoon Young-hae, Yi Hyo-jae, Jung Jin-sung, Shin Hye-soo. I think with the exception of one, all were sincere Christian. And Yoon Jong-ok, Yi Hyo-jae, two major representatives of Korean Council, they were both daughters of Korean ministers. And Yoon Mi-hang graduated from theological seminary, very liberal seminary in South Korea. Yoon Young-hae, Shin Hye-soo, they also, they were wives of Korean pastor or they are pastor, yeah. So even though South Korean churches are very conservative, women church leaders, they are very liberal and they united to change society. Many progressive movement they were engaged in. Korean Church Women United fought against sex tourism by Japanese businessmen for two decades, 1970s and 80s, while Korean Women's Association United fought hard against military governments' sexual interrogation of college activist women in 1960, 86 and after. Here I listed the major women's organization emerged, and you can see many are Christian organizations. The first one, Young Women's Christian Association, YWCA, still is very active. During the colonization period, they were not active, but just after that, also they engaged in many progressive social issue, yeah. Korean Legal Aid Center, the leader, Lee Tae-young, she was also a sincere Christian. Korean National Council of Women, Korean Church Women United, established 1967. This organization played a key role, yeah. Many women, in different denominations, they were united, while male pastors, they were engaged in power struggle, dividing into all different denominations. Women were united, and they tried to reform society. And then you have here Korean Women's Association United, created in 1987 to fight against the military government. This is a very powerful organization. All women's organization, they were united together and they sent their representative. Then they have local branches in different cities. So they have hundreds of, small organizations. Yeah. Korean companies who came back home could not come out to society, mainly because of Confucian cultural tradition, because of tradition that emphasized women's chastity and stigmatized sexual victims. The women's movement by various organizations played a significant role in challenging the norm, stigmatizing victims of sexual violence. So I will talk about, I will spend a few minutes to talking about Korean Chochiman United Fight Against Sex Tourism by Japanese businessman. Kiseng, traditionally kaisha, originally referred to young women who entertained a small group of men at drinking party. The women were well-trained in performing art, such as singing, dancing, and playing. In the 1970s, President Park Jong-il, military dictator, encouraged or at least condoned sex tourism by Japanese businessmen to Korea as a means of obtaining foreign currency to support his fragile military government. The number of visitors for sex tourism reached 1 million in 1978. Unlike traditional Kiseng girls, the women hired for Kiseng houses to serve Japanese men usually came from poor families. After party in a fancy restaurant, each Japanese man selected a girl to sexually serve him for one or more night at his hotel room. Tourist agencies, Kiseng houses, and major hotels made a great deal of money from this exploitation of poor Korean girls. Beginning in 1973, Korean Chochiman United initiated a campaign to eradicate sex tourism. Korean women's organization staged a demonstration in front of Japanese embassy in Seoul and Gimpo International Airport, criticizing Japanese businessmen for buying up girls for money and the Korean military government for dehumanizing women for the good of the nation. And the Japanese Christian Women's Organization did the same thing at Haneda Airport, and they coordinated with the Korean Chochiman United. Again, not many Christian in Japan, but at the time, Christian organization were very progressive in Japan too. In 1985, Korean government and Seoul Olympic Organizing Committee conducted a vigorous advertising campaign to attract foreign tourists to Korea for the upcoming 1986 Asian Games and 88 Summer Games, both scheduled in Seoul. In October 1986, Korean daily newspaper published an article regarding September 30 special issue of Sports News, a US weekly sporting magazine. It included a picture of a smiling Korean Kiseng girl putting food into foreign tourist mouths. Korean Chochiman United sent a letter to the relevant government ministry and Seoul Olympic Committee protesting the commercialization of sex as a means to earning money. They asked the government for cultural tourism, not sex tourism. In June 1988, Korean Cho Chi Minh United organized an international conference focusing on women and tourism, in which about 120 women leaders from Korea, Japan, US, Great Britain, Netherlands, and Germany participated. Significantly, Yoon Jong-ok, the woman who took the leading role in the Redress Movement, presented a paper titled Korean Comfortment During the World War II in the conference. Her presentation was partly based on the result of a field trip to Okinawa, Fukuoka, and Hokkaido in Japan that she and other members of Korean Cho Chi Minh United had made in February 1988. Yoon's presentation shocked the international audience, especially the Japan Christian Women's Moral Reform Society. According to Yoon Jong-e, a staff member of KCW, one Japanese woman felt so ashamed of what Japanese military had done to Korean women. She knelt down and cried. Korean feminist organization also fought against the sexual abuse of college activist women by the police in the 1980s, which also contributed to women's awareness of the comportment issue. General Chun Doo-hwan, Park Jong-hee was assassinated in 1979, and Chun Doo-hwan, second military dictator in Korea, he seized the power by using military force in 1980. President Chun relaxed his dictatorship beginning in 1983, when the International Olympic Committee selected Seoul as the site of 1988 Summer Olympic Games. So to change image, he relaxed his dictatorship. The relaxation of restriction encouraged the democratic movement against the military government. Both male and female college students participated in the demonstration that brought traffic standstill on many streets in Seoul for many days between 1983 and 1987. Military dictatorship came to an end in 1987. As a means of discouraging women students from participating in the demonstration, police used the Seonggomun interrogation involving sexual abuse in the mid-1980s. The sexual abuse included humiliating women with sexually oriented curses and verbal abuse, physically punishing women after they had been stripped nude, and forms of sexual violence ranging from breast fondling to rape. Many of the women who experienced sexual abuse at the hand of police did not report to the media because in a highly patriarchal society, they had more to lose than to gain from its publicity. In Suk-kwon was one of the female college student activists. She was a Seoul National University student who stayed at factories as undercover workers to help organize exploited girls and women workers organize labor movement. At the time, military government completely banned labor movement, including factory workers movement, and many college female college students, they disguised them as workers and tried to organize them. So now in the US, college students don't undertake these responsibility, but at the time, college students, they did a lot. The police arrested Kwon on the charge that she had been using false identification card for undercover employment. A police officer raped her as part of her interrogation. The police officer said to her, it is useless to tell prosecutor what happened to you. We belong to the same system. So military government condoned sexual abuse of women activists. Detained in a jail, one contemplated suicide, but she realized that she should not let herself be destroyed by the same evil that had destroyed so many women before her. She had the courage to make her experience of sexual violence known to the world. In a press conference, she testified that she had been raped by a police officer. The announcement of Kwon's sexual victimization by the police angered not only feminist leaders, but also other anti-government religious leaders, intellectuals, and college students who had been already fighting for constitutional amendment for presidential election. The Special Citizens Committee organized sued police officer who had raped Kwon and organized demonstration protesting use of rape as a way to suppress the democratic movement. Later, police officer received only 3-year prison term sentence. In the US, you cannot understand, but they thought that, you know, it was their victory still while Kwon was released. I should move faster. I will talk about beginning of the movement. The women's movement in South Korea up to 1987 targeted sexual tourism by Japanese businessmen and sexual interrogation of college women by the police officer. These two issues had a similarity to confinement issue because patriarchal culture and military regime contributed to sexual violence against women. In Korea, Korean women's focus on sexual violence against women in Korea led them to pay attention to accompaniment issue. In particular, Yoon's paper on the accompaniment issue at the International Women's Conference focused on sex tourism played a key role. Yoon Jung-wook was the first person who both conducted the research on the accompaniment issue and who initiated Redress Movement for the victims of Japanese military sexual slavery. This is her photo taken in around 2000 when they had Women's International War Crimes Tribunal was preparing. They were preparing in Japan. And I think at that time she was in her 70s. But really, she made it, yeah. Everything, a accompaniment movement owes to her. She was the beginner and very sincere. With a PhD degree from university in the US in English literature, Yoon had taught at Ewha Women's University between 1957 and 1991. 1991, at the age of 65, she retired, and she just, you know, was active in the movement after that. In 1943, when Japanese military government was taking many Korean women to Japanese military brothel, she was 17 years old, first year student at Ewha Women's College. One day in November 1943, Yoon and her college friend were forced by Japanese teachers to sign a statement saying that they would support general national mobilization law. Under this law, they mobilized so many women and either they were sent to factories or sent to compensation. However, following her parents' advice. Her parent, her father was a minister, and family was middle-class family. She soon quit school to avoid being drafted into the 정신대. They mobilized the girls in the name of 정신대, either to send to factories or to compass station. She and her parents moved back to the rural area where she was born to escape from mobilization. But many of her school friends were mobilized, and she felt guilty about that. Yoon told me that Korean women forcefully mobilized Japanese military for war would have been subjected to sexual exploitation from many returning Korean forced workers and soldiers' testimony after war. She was convinced that many Korean women mobilized as the 정신대 for factory work were sexually exploited, and that most of them did not survive to return home, while other women who returned home kept silent because of feeling shame. She confessed that she felt guilty because she was able to avoid the fate of a victim of military slavery by virtue of her better family background. She began to conduct research on Korean accompaniment by visiting Okinawa and Kyushu to meet with Paebongdi, Korean accompaniment, who were trapped in Okinawa. In 1980, at the age of 54, she realized she needed institutional support to continue her field work to Japanese city and other Asian countries where accompaniment was established. What she did, you know, she visited the city where, you know, it was known there was a compass station, and then asked the village people about compass station and whether Korean, Japanese, other women were there. That's the field work, yeah. Once women emerged, their testimony was the main thing, but at the time, this is the only way to trace the legacy of compass station, yeah. So she needed some institutional support, and Hyojari, she was another Iwa University professor, but she was a feminist and activist, really, social movement leader. And she asked Lee Hyojae, another faculty member at the Emergence University, to find any organization to work together. And Lee Hyojae introduced Yoon to Korean Church Women United in the late 1980. And really, Korean Council was emerged from this organization. The major impetus for the Redress Movement came in September 1990, when Korean Women's Organization obtained a minute of a national diet of Japan that included exchange between Motoka Shoji, a member of Japanese Socialist Party, and the Director General Shimizu Sutao, a member of the Employment Security Bureau. In a Diet Budget Committee meeting on June 6, 1990, Shoji pointed out that Japanese government had forcefully drafted more than 1.5 million people from Korea during the World War II, and that it had hunted young Korean women to serve as sexual slaves. He found a document saying that he recommended that the Japanese government investigate compartment issue, make a formal apology to, and provide compensation for the victim. But Shimizu responded that he could not investigate it because compartment system had been carried out by private entrepreneurs. It's a lie. Japanese government silence led 37 Korean women's organizations to establish a Korean Council for the Women Threatened for Military Sexual Slavery by Japan in November 1990. Receiving reminders from Korean Council again and again, Japanese embassy invited the leader of Korean Council in April 1991. The counselor repeated the same argument that there is no evidence for accompaniment's forced mobilization. Yun Jong-un, another leader who attended the meeting said, he told us to bring evidence of any. By evidence, we thought he meant any surviving Korean accompaniment. They must have believed that no surviving accompaniment would be able to come forward to tell the truth that she served dozens of Japanese soldiers every day. They must have thought all surviving victims would die soon, and that then there would be no evidence as long as the Japanese government did not release document. After meeting at the embassy, Japanese embassy, leaders of the Korean Council realized that they had to find the surviving victim who could testify about their sexual slavery. Through the media, Korean Council asked the surviving Korean compartment to come forward to challenge the Japanese government's denial of sexual slavery. One night in July 1991, Korean atomic bomb victim close to Korean church women, United brought a woman, Kim Ak-sun, to the Korean Council office. In a tape recorded interview, Kim said, I was forced to serve as a accompaniment for Japanese soldiers during World War II. As the Japanese government continued to tell lies about accompaniment issue, I cannot but expose its deceit by telling the truth. Yoon promised Kim that she would call her after arranging a press conference where she could give her testimony. Yoon had been eagerly looking for surviving Korean accompaniment to challenge Japanese government, but she was shocked by Kim's willingness to testify about her experience as a accompaniment. She said, if Kim Harmony grandma reveals her story about serving many Japanese soldiers in front of TV camera, it would bury her in the Korean patriarchal cultural milieu. I did not want to kill her twice. So she was hesitating to organize a press conference. After several days, Kim called Yoon and asked her why it was taking so long to arrange a conference. Press conference. Yoon reported her reluctance to make Kim testify because of the damaging effect it could have on her future life. Kim, who was 67, responded, I have a short life to live. I am afraid of nothing because I have neither my husband nor other family members. No, she was married, but husband died, children died too because of her venereal disease and early. Would you arrange a press conference as soon as possible? And so they had a press conference. You see Kim Ak-sun, she is globally known as the first woman who formally testified. And Yoon Jong-un is over there on the right side. On August 14, 1991, this is the eve of Korean Independence Day. August 15 is Independence Day. Thursday before, the Korean independent Kim gave her testimony in a press conference held in an office of Korean Chosimon United. I suffered as a Japanese military accompaniment during the World War II. I was taken and forced into prostitution by the Japanese military. How can Japanese government deny that its predecessor took Korean women by force to comfort Japanese soldier? Kim Il-sung was the first Korean survivor of Japanese military sexual slavery to testify in Korea through formal press conference. However, two other Korean women gave their past history as complement, one in 1972 and the other in April 1981. The first one in 1972, I first found her. In my interview, she confessed, but her interview to Korean Council, she didn't say that. Yeah, and much earlier, she wanted it, but President Park's first lady, Yoo Ge-sang, told her, she said, you should keep silent and, you know, peaceful time, your story will be known, yeah. Following Kim, many other Korean accompaniment survivors, 239 came forward to tell the truth. Many accompaniment in North Korea, about 100, Taiwan, about 45, China, Philippines, Indonesia, Thailand, and Netherlands followed Kim in revealing their accompaniment past. Other Korean accompaniment followed Kim in revealing their accompaniment past, but with much difficulty because of their family members and relatives. For example, Kim Sun-dok, with three married children, said that she could not sleep for 3 weeks after she had seen Kim on television. After much hesitation, she told her niece about her past and asked whether she should report it. She said, my niece advised me not to report it because the news would have a negative effect on my son's marital issue. In January 1992, Kim Bok-dong was a major leader of the movement. She received award from many international human rights organizations. But Kim Bok-dong heard a television announcement that urged the Korean accompaniment to report to the Korean Council. Before reporting, she consulted her older sister, who told her not to report it, especially her children's sake. After several days of hesitation, she decided to report. She said that her older sister cut ties with her after her report. I think until she died, they were separated, yeah. But because I don't have time, I just didn't include enough, but so many Korean accompaniment with a lot of hesitation, they reported it. Now, Lee Yong-soo, she is still very active. We have something like 11 surviving accompaniment still. She is the most active woman. And she went to daily, 9 times. You know, she went there to report, then she came back. And 9th time, she reported her name, and she said, this is my friend, You know, how difficult it is to report. But most reported because they were angry. They didn't do anything. Simply, their home country, the powers we colonized, that's why they were taken. Why they treat them as a prostitute? They were angry. But because of patriarchal tradition, you know, they cannot emerge. But, you know, when opportunity came, everybody tried to tell the truth. They didn't listen to their sisters or other relatives, no? For their family name, they just try to hide, but you know, they chose to report because they thought this is unfair. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Min, for your presentation tonight. We have a few questions so far here. There is a Gloria Steele. She makes mention of the Harvard law professor, Ramsayer, recently in his article argued that Korean women were given voluntary contracts to work for Japanese army as prostitutes. He provides evidence that this was the case for some Japanese women, but was there ever a case where Korean women agreed to such contracts? Now, I know that this month, or maybe it's already been published, you have an article that you published in order to rebut his article. So maybe you want to discuss that.
Yeah, yeah. Not published yet. They are keeping it, yeah. Well, I think several people responded to his article, and historian can check. His article has 5.5 pages, excluding footnote and references, really short article. So historian can check his what document he used, and there are several articles by historian already published showing that he didn't use proper, real, you know, reliable document. But I, as a sociologist, have a different, you know, I don't have to do that. Historian can check whether documents are correct or not. Now, my argument, he said Japanese and Korean companymen were mobilized based on their contract. And you cannot treat Korean and Japanese companymen together. Huh? I think most Japanese companymen were mobilized out of prostitution houses. Huh? Definitely, Japanese government cannot take unmarried young girl like a Korean girl. You know, Korean girls, Korean companymen's age start from 11 to something like 27. And 93% of Korean companymen, 103, I used 103 testimony, they were mobilized before 21. At the time, only women 21 or older were able to engage in prostitution. Huh? And definitely younger girls, doesn't matter how they are mobilized, it's forced because they were young girls. They cannot make their own decision. Huh? They belong to parents. And, but I think most Japanese companymen are 21 or older, so they are eligible. So you cannot, you know, treat Korean companymen with Japanese companymen together. And then he was saying, you know, they were mobilized for prostitution with the labor contract, but from prostitution houses. Korean young girl under 21, they cannot go to prostitution houses. You know? They are saying they came from prostitution houses. You know? That's wrong. And then I used my data consisting of 130 testimony, whether they received money or not. And none of them received labor contract. That's wrong. Huh? Most were just forced by Japanese police or employment fraud. They told the lie. That's forced mobilization. Huh? And out of 103, I found 8 women received money. Fee, 40% or more of the fee paid by soldiers, because they worked in officers' club. In officers' club, usually Japanese women worked and they were paid. But some lucky Korean women, because they speak Japanese fluently or they sing very well, they were allowed to work there. Out of 103, only 8 people, and none of them had a contract. That's completely wrong, yeah. Unless he used a fake document, he cannot just prove Korean women had a document. And then I also indicated several women he didn't describe correctly, including Munokju. Munokju, she got money from tip. Most people received the tip, and you know that's a regular fee. Huh? And some women saved money. And Munokju saved a large amount of money. But, you know, at the end of the war, because of inflation, the value of money significantly dropped when she came back. And more than that, she deposited them in Japanese post office. And she couldn't get the money back. So, but Ramjeon exaggerated. She was very happy and made a lot of money without knowing that actually she couldn't get any money back. And again, that was a tip because she spoke Japanese fluently and she sang very well. She was invited to officers club very often, and she saved a significant amount. But she also tried to commit suicide, and you know, Japanese officer tried to kill her, and she used a knife against him, and she was released because. You know, at the time, it's a formal protection, so she was okay. But anyway, she had a lot of trouble, but Ramji or many other Japanese neo-nationalists pick up particular person who received the money and try to generalize it. That's why in my book, I gave 28 tables. And almost all were forcibly mobilized. Almost all didn't receive any fee, even though many received some tips. That's my response to this article.
Oh, sure. We have a question from a Frank Gomez. Is there new research being done to complement your work? And what is the view of the Korean government about retribution? Earlier on in the introductions, I did mention 2 days ago, the South Korean judge did overturn an earlier ruling back in January regarding payment back to at least 12 comfort women. Can you want to share your thoughts?
Yeah, I have my thought about that. I didn't support South Korean organization that pushed, you know, to get the judgment that, you know, Japan should fulfill obligation. Twice, Korean women large proportion of Korean women receive the money. Right now, they should not receive money. Main thing, they should acknowledge the crime and make a sincere apology. And the Korean court cannot ask the Japanese government to make a sincere apology. I don't think they can do that. Only Japanese government volunteer to do that. And if they don't do it, they will suffer that damage internationally, a significant negative effect. And if they don't recognize Japanese military sexual slavery as a slavery, they say it's just prostitution, then, you know, within Japan, they have a censorship. If someone say it's a sexual slavery, they will be arrested. Now that's the way. So not to recognize crime and not to make a sincere apology, they have to sacrifice many democratic principles in Japan. And that hurt a lot. Yeah, not only, you know, negative damage internationally, internally, they have to control people because there are many activists and people who want to tell the truth. Number two, internally, 10 companies group made a lawsuit against the Japanese government. And all 10 times, Japanese court said no. So there is no three-branch division. Japanese court should just give judgment to support Japanese government. And that's a huge compromise of democratic principle. So Japanese government internally, they know, you know, they sacrifice many democratic principles. So if movement continues, then they also suffer internally. That's all we can do. We cannot make Japanese government forcefully. Any court can do anything. It very much depends on their decision. And you know, as long as liberal democratic party control power, they won't do that. All politicians, including Abe and the current prime minister, they are radical historical revisionist, unbelievably, yeah. And many books, you know, using their argument, there is no evidence to deny company system as sexual slavery. In Japan, a lot of material there, and as long as current LDP party control government, they won't change. That doesn't mean that we have to give up. Movement should continue. And the South Korean Korean Council, earlier they told the Japanese leader they will continue 200 years, continue movement. They should do that. That's all they can do. But I don't think any court can, you know, make Japan to make a sincere apology. Well, if money alone is involved, they can say they should pay. But making apology and acknowledging crime, you cannot make them to do that. Any other country cannot tell that. Yeah. Even international organization cannot do it. They advise them to do that. They recommend, but, you know, it's up to them. But if they continue, they sacrifice a lot of things. Yeah. Women's position is terrible in Japan. Still, prostitution is very active. South Korea, they abolished commercial prostitution 2006.
We have a comment regarding your data set. Now, you said you interviewed 103 comfort women for your study. The person is saying that there's over 20,000, 50,000. How did you come up with the 103 or
you mean more? total number of accompaniment mobilized?
Yeah,
that's an interesting question. Now, like Yoshiaki Yoshimi is a very important Japanese scholar. I think I admire him a lot. And he and others, Japanese scholar, they estimate total number of compartment mobilized using particular formula. One is how many soldiers one woman served, no? And at the time, there were 30 million Japanese soldiers. Huh? And one woman can serve 30 or 100, they use two formula. Huh? Yeah. If we assume, you know, the ratio between soldier and compartment was 10 to 1 or 30 to 1, huh? You can estimate, assuming there were 3 million Japanese soldiers mobilized. Huh? And then you have to add attrition rate. Huh? Many women died there. I assume more than one third of Korean compartment died or killed, huh? Died of venereal disease or some other disease, or they were killed. Huh? So you have to add that. Huh? And I think that if you assume one woman served 30 soldiers and about half of them changed, huh? Then that's a maximum 200,000. If one woman served 100 soldiers and attrition rate is less than that, then minimum is 50,000. So it's an estimation. And a lot of Koreans say 200,000 Korean women were mobilized. No, that's wrong. Altogether, maximum is 200,000. But in my book, I indicated more than 3 million soldiers, because compartment served the Japanese politician, official, and also workers. And even, you know, many coal mine workers. So the total number 3 million should be increased. And I can say 200,000 is not exaggeration, definitely. But maybe 70,000 Korean women. Korean women, they assume the largest group, but Chinese scholars say more Chinese women were mobilized because their calculation, Chinese women stayed the compost station shorter period. Huh? They didn't keep them long time, huh? Because of security issue and also other issue. So fast turnover, that means you need more people. And you know, using their formula, something like four time, changed. Then they had 300,000 Chinese women, but I disagree. Yeah, I think four times is too much.
Yeah, but I think the person from the audience asking the question is, how did you end up with just 103 women to include inside your book? Did you have more that you could have interviewed and included in your study?
Well, I used 103 testimony collected by Korean Council. But I personally interviewed 22 company women. And 20 of them were included in the testimony there. But still, many of them gave new pieces of information when they respond to interview there. They didn't ask that question. So like the women who tried to tell First Lady, she was forcibly mobilized. You know, they didn't get it, but I found some other new piece of information. But also, I interviewed 46 activists in Japan, Korea, and US. So I have a chapter on the movement in the US. So, because my book covered both movement and the government issue, their historical experience. Component as a data basis, I used, but I used many interviews with the activists, but also I used a lot of resources made by Korean Council. They have a monthly report and a newsletter and a lot of important information. So I depended upon Korean Council. They have many sources there. I was able to use it.
Okay. We have another comment regarding Professor Ramsayer, the Harvard Law School professor. They're wondering why did he write the article? Was there someone behind him politically to write the article?
Well, I just faculty member, associate editor, asked me to write. So I wrote, but I don't know what they are doing. They said in April they will publish, but they are not. And maybe they are not decided whether they keep Ramsayer's article or not. Definitely should not be included. It's not worthwhile. And already some patients are using that to publicize in Japan. But it's not worthwhile to be included in academic journal.
I see. An audience member says that in terms of apologies, for Koreans from Japan, it seems as if Japan has already apologized multiple times. Example is 2001's prime minister sent personal letters to victims of Korea. So I guess what in terms of the redress movement can satisfy, you know, sort of all the people who are sort of against this?
You are asking to resolve the issue between Korea and Japan, what they should do. Let me tell you. Japanese government tried to resolve the issue twice. First, in 1995, using Asian Women's Fund, and they tried to give about $20,000 to each victim. Not only Korean, but other Asian component victim. Korean Council organization, major organization, rejected that money because they used the civilian donation. They should use government money to make reparation. The Japanese government committed a crime and they need state reparation, not just donation by people. That's why Asian solidarity group, most countries rejected, but like Philippines, they are poor. So about 200 received the money, more than 200. In South Korea, eight women secretly accepted the money. And then Kim Dae-jung, president in 1998, he used the government money to give them and not to receive money from Japanese government. Not Japanese government, Asian Women's Fund, they collected donation and you cannot resolve the issue in that way. Money is not the only issue. And then clearly, when they sent to certification, they are saying, we feel greater moral responsibility. No, they should say legal responsibility. Japanese government has legal responsibility to resolve, and they didn't do that. They don't want to acknowledge a crime, simply they want to help money because they have difficulty. That's a charity money. You cannot resolve the issue. Now, then 2015, Japanese government gave 1 billion yen, a lot of money. At the time, about 55 Korean survivors, other people died. And if they distribute money, a lot of money. Anyway, they tried to give about $100,000, a lot of money. But 34 Korean women received about 15 rejected. And then Korean Council collected donation and gave money to the others. So I think they, survivors who survived until recently, they received a lot of money. But still, at the time when they had agreement, Japanese government made an apology. My heart breaking to think about your suffering, things like that. But you don't need that. Main thing, we acknowledge it is sexual slavery, and we make sincere apology. Abe didn't do that, and that's not a solution. And you know what? Many people, many even Koreans say we receive the money. So and two presidents agreed, so it resolved. But UN sent message to Japanese government saying it's not Korean Japan, with diplomatic problem. It's a human rights issue involving all Asian victims. Why Japanese government give a lot of money only to Korean women? Because movement is very active in Korea. To shut their mouths, they try to give a lot of money. And it's not a solution. Japanese women's organization sent a letter to Japanese government saying it's not just a Korean-Japan issue. If you want to resolve the issue, they don't have to spend money now. They simply say, acknowledge the crime. Every piece of evidence they have. And then make a sincere apology. They don't need money right now. Yeah. So some people, some Korean received the money, so it's solved. Many Japanese citizens say how many times they are asking. But it's not just the money issue, monetary issue. And that's why the recent court result, I don't, I accept that. And I don't accept activist claim. You cannot make them make a sincere apology. It upon completely depend upon their decision. But if they don't do it, it hurts their mind. So movement should continue.
Sure. Have a question regarding the US movement in regards to this subject. In the Bay Area, I believe in New Jersey, there's comfort women statues that were erected. But then there's people in the community who were against the statues from being put up, and then even asked from the Japanese government itself, writing to these local officials here to sort of take them down and stuff. What's the sort of status of the redress movement over here?
Okay, in the US, they used a different movement technique. First time, when most of the companies and survivors were able to travel, they used testimony in 1990s and even 2000 first half of very active testimony at university here, at Columbia several times, and Georgetown University, many, Yale University, so many, about 50 universities, they gave testimony 4 or 5 times. And really, that touched their heart. Faculty members and students, intellectuals, they showed respect, they appreciate their courage to come out to in the Japanese government. So it was very effective. Yeah. Then next strategy, passing resolution, getting resolution passed by state legislature or US House of Representatives. And 2007, US House of Representatives passed unanimously, top resolution, and they sent it to Japanese government. Same similar resolution UN and other human rights organizations sent to Japan. You have to acknowledge the crime, make investigation, and make a sincere apology, and compensation acceptable to the victim. You have to communicate with the victim what they want. And then build memorials in commemoration of victim, and then include information textbook. Same thing, many organizations and US House of Representatives passed, they sent them. And then many state, 10 state government, including New York, New Jersey, and Maryland here, they passed a similar resolution. And third thing is building memorial, comfort goal statue or monument. And right now we have 15 monument, memorial. 3 of them were inside the Korean Association, and no, it's not public area or Koreatown. It's not effective. Important thing is build a monument in public place outside of Korean community, and 12 of them are outside, 12. And first one was built in Palisade Park. And now Palisade Park, we have 3 complement monument, and another one in New Jersey. Then Virginia, there is one, and San Francisco, in the largest city, 2017 established. Then Glendale in Los Angeles. In the neighborhood where there are many Koreans, really Koreans did a lot, some Chinese was involved in San Francisco, most other places, Koreans made a Korean compliment statue. Then last one is including information, compliment information in history textbook here. And that's what we can continue here. And I want to help, we can check East Asian history textbook for high school students and include the information. Earlier, Japanese government found only one book was included. They intervened. They went to a publisher and author, and they had big trouble. Many scholars, said, don't intervene in the US. Imagine if, US consulate include in Tokyo and ask them about change textbook, you cannot do that. I have to see how many, only one book had that problem, and Japanese government intervened and they had a lot of trouble. So we can do that. And then by teaching, this class, spread. Many people know, but many others don't know yet. And when they don't know, when Japanese government say there is no evidence, they accept it. That's why we have to teach and give valid information. And similarly, they can, in California, working with the school district to change the curriculum, include complement issue. Yeah. So that area is, in the future, I think we can do a lot. Now, because of pandemic, we cannot visit, but later, we can do more about that. And it's powerful. You know, here you have many human rights organizations, very, very critical media, New York Times, Washington Post, and you have a lot, many Jewish centers. They are very helpful. They help the Korean complement activists a lot. Yeah. So, and actually, Japanese government spend a lot of money to block movement here. Yeah. They are afraid of monument. They are scared. Yeah. I think complement monument is one thing they are very scared about. Because that reminded them their crime. They try to hide the crime, but they see it. Yeah. And they don't like a sexual slavery term. No, they want to play leading role at UN. Japanese government. And one time Abe gave a speech saying, we want to donate a lot of money to help women in poor country. And many people laughed them. At UN, Japan has a problem. They had an ambition for becoming social security council member. But UN knows, UN sent a resolution 15 times, 20 times to Japanese government. And they know what Japanese government has done, and they cannot do much at UN. Yeah.
Before we conclude, just to remind everybody, Professor Min's book is available for purchase. You can go to the link on our website or directly to the Rutgers University's press website. That's the paperback, right? So the paperback is only $44.95, and there are also PDF and EPUB versions available for the same price. So please do purchase it for your classroom or for gifts, add it to your library, et cetera. The Institute is also hosting another talk on the topic of comfort women on May 28th, that's a Friday. Poet Tanya Ko Hong, she will read from her latest book of poetry entitled The Wars Still Within, Poems of the Korean Diaspora. So I hope that you'll join us for that talk, those of you who are online here. And with that, I wanna thank everybody for joining us tonight for this talk. If you haven't been vaccinated yet, please do so. The mayor just announced today that select city-run sites are now accepting walk-ins. So 16 and above, just walk in, get vaccinated. And also in light of the recent anti-Asian sentiment going across the country, I hope that all of you will be upstanders, not just bystanders, and help out your fellow person when you see them in need. And with that, be safe, have a wonderful weekend. Thank you very much, Professor Min, for your talk, and good night, everybody.
Thank you for giving me the opportunity. Yeah.
No problem. Have a good weekend, everybody. Bye-bye.